So, today we are going to talk about logistic regression. It is another form of regression that is a bit more advanced than linear regression, fixing some of its bad habits, one might say. So we are looking into the setting of binary classification problems. We are given a feature space X. It is a p-dimensional feature space of real numbers. And it is an inner product space, so we can calculate distances and similarities. We have two classes, 0 and 1, hence binary classification problem. They could be encoded differently, minus 1, 1, or the different notations we have seen before. But for logistic regression, it is common and typical to use the classes 0 and 1. You will see why in a minute. We have a classifier that maps the examples from the feature space to the classes. And as usual in machine learning, we do not know the real or ideal classifier that does so. Instead, we are given a set of examples, D, for which we do know the classification, so the result of the function C of X. And our goal, as usual, in this case as well, is to approximate the classifier C. And we want to do so by exploiting the knowledge that is found in the data D that we are given. And we want to do so using the so-called logistic model function, hence logistic regression. For example, binary classification problems could be whether an email is spam or its opposite, ham, I think it's called. So an email that we want versus an email that we do not want. There could be other binary classification problems, whether a patient that we somehow have modeled based on data that we know about the patient from medical tests, whether the patient is infected with the disease or whether the patient is healthy. Or, as a usual running example, we also have whether a bank customer is creditworthy or not. But let's stick to the email example in what follows. So, as a quick recap, let's look again at linear regression. In the one-dimensional case, we might try to distinguish emails that are spam from emails that are ham, here encoded as 1 for spam and 0 for ham emails, by simply counting the number of obscene words that are found in the email. So if the number is higher, the more likely it is that the email is spam. And we have a number of examples given here of ham emails, which contain a number of obscene words, but not that many. So there could be normal emails that do contain obscene words, of course. But if the number of obscene words rises, then very likely it will be spam emails. And the examples that we have indicate as much. And in linear regression, we try to fit a linear model function here, given again as the multiplication of a weight vector with the feature vector x. Here we have just one dimension, so we have only this x as a feature plus padded with a 1 in order to account for the for the weight w0. And what we get if we fit a linear regression line to this model function to this data, we get this line, for example. You can see my mouse, right?
Yes.
Thank you. And if we were now to predict or to actually classify, as we have seen before, using linear regression, we need to find a discrimination point. And in this case, we choose the discrimination point 0.5, which is right in the middle between the zero class and the one class, and we find the value on the x-axis of number of obscene word, the value x prime, which if we found an email with that many words of obscene words, we would switch our decision from ham email to spam email, which is indicated here by the greater than or equal sign. So if we encounter x prime many obscene words in an email, then we say it's a spam mail. Or if we encounter more such words than x prime. Otherwise, we say it's a ham email. And this is then basically our prediction. Now look at this situation. We are given another example. And this example contains a great many number of obscene words. And this example has an effect on what the model function will look like if we include it into our training. It pulls basically the model function, or it changes the slope of the model function so that it has a smaller slope and therefore can account for this example as well. If you remember, we want to minimize the distance of the predicted model value here from the expected model value here for all examples that we have. And this line better fits this number of examples where we have number of examples which seem to contain a normal amount of obscene words for a spam email, and one example which contains an extreme many amount of obscene words. Also notice that we have a different number of examples here which are positive, which are considered spam emails, versus only a small number of examples which are not spam emails but ham emails. So also this imbalance causes the linear regression line to have a different shape than in the previous example here. Why is this a problem? So if we again choose the 0.5, the x prime, which if input into our model function yields a 0.5 prediction as our discrimination point, then we will see that two of the examples that are actually spam emails are now not considered spam emails anymore, because for them the prediction would be below 0.5, and hence our prediction rule says these emails are probably ham emails. And the only reason this happens is because we have one such email which contains a great many number of obscene words, which pulls, as I said before, the slope of the which pushes the slope of the linear regression line down. And we call such examples here outliers, or in German Ausreißer. And what we actually want from machine learning is to not be susceptible too much to this situation. So there may always be outliers. Also with regards to the opposite class, we may find outliers, and we also do not want them to influence too much our decisions. We want the decision to be commensurate with the normal situation that we usually expect disregarding outliers. And we can accomplish this by changing, or by imposing a restriction on the model function. And this restriction could be this. We do not want the model function to exceed the class values that we have chosen for our two classes. We do not want the model functions to exceed one, because values greater than one increase the residual sum of squares. And if we have an extreme case where the number of obscene words in spam emails is extremely high, then the distance to the model function will still be high, therefore affecting very much the learning of the model function. And of course, the same applies for any values below zero. So we would like our model function to be restricted in this way. However, in linear regression, we do not have this liberty in this current example using the model function that we just chose. These model functions increase monotonous as the number of obscene words increases. And if we find an email which has thousands of obscene words in them, the distance to the model function would be huge, and hence the squared distance too. If you look at this function, it is a different kind of function. And this is the function that we will use, or from which we will construct our logistic regression model function. This is a so-called sigmoid function, or this function is basically called the logistic function, which belongs to a class of functions which are called sigmoid function. Sigmoid functions are all characterized by having an S shape in this way. So at some point, the function arises, then it has a turning point, and then it the increase is bounded by one again. So this function is bounded on two sides. Here, one is the boundary, and at the bottom, zero is the boundary. And this function can be simply constructed by computing for any value z, 1 divided by 1 plus e to the power of minus z. E is the Euler number, just for you to recall. So this is called the logistic function. And it has been invented specifically also for logistic regression. And in order to be able to combine this with our linear regression function, we simply use the linear regression model that we have, the linear function, and use this as our value z that we input into the sigmoid function. Thereby we obtain a new model function, and we call this y of x, which is basically sigma of y transposed times x, which is then simply 1 divided by 1 plus e to the power of minus w transposed to x. Sorry, I said y here, of course I meant w. So by putting the value that we compute with linear regression into the sigmoid function, we basically project this value onto this line, dependent on its dependence on its magnitude. And therefore, we end up with a new kind of model function that will hopefully help us to avoid this situation. That is the situation in linear regression. So the domain of this model function continues to be the p plus one dimensional real number space, which was also the basis for our linear regression function. And the range of this function is the open interval between 0 and 1. So the values 0 and 1 are never actually reached by this function. An interesting interpretation of this function is, or an interesting result that has been found, that I will just give to you but not prove to you, is that the computation of y of x for any given example x, if it happens that the example x belongs to the class 1, is basically the probability of x belonging to the class 1, given its feature representation and the weights that we have chosen or learned. So by computing y of x, we compute the probability that c of x is 1, given x under the trained weight values. So coming back to our example, we have our x is composed of two values, x0 and x1. One is the default value that we apply for the weight W0 into our model. And X1 is basically the number of obscene words. And if we have now an example given, for example, here X1, which has where the email has 5 obscene words in it, and we compute using our model function a value of, for example, 0.67, this means that this is the probability of that email being spam. So under 100 different emails which contain 5 obscene words, 67% of them are spam. If our set of examples that we have, like, okay, so let's stick here. If our set of examples that we have tells us as much. So if, for example, we see here an overlap at the position 5 of 67% of emails being spam versus the 1 minus 67%, like 33% being not spam, being ham. So if there's an overlap between those classes here, which is usually the case in machine learning, this is an ideal situation that we have constructed here, which usually does not exist. So this can be proven, and I will spare you the proof now. We have not prepared it here. But if you want to go deeper into logistic regression, this is certainly very, very important to know that logistic regression actually gives us probabilities, true probabilities. And again, with this probability, we can do our classification that we want to achieve by predicting that a given email X represented as a feature vector X is spam if and only if its sigmoid function computes a value bigger or equal to 0.5. And otherwise we say it's not spam. All of this can be again generalized to higher dimensionalities here, for example, again, for 2 dimensions or even higher dimensions. So as a recap, let's look again at the situation in linear regression in 2 dimensions, where we have a number of negative examples and a number of positive examples. Here, just not for you to be confused, we have the default encoding that we have chosen for linear regression, which you will find more often in the books on linear regression. The default encoding of positive examples is 1 and negative examples is -1. And our linear regression function with 3 weights and 2 dimensions, x1 and x2, will result in a plane in this space, which will try and fit these positive and negative examples as good as possible by minimizing the residual sum of squares. And again, we have the same situation as before. If there's an outlier or many outliers of positive examples here, they may pull the plane towards them. Or if there are many more negative examples than positive examples, or vice versa, this may affect this plane that we train. Therefore, we would like also for this plane to be bounded by its maximum value, the value 1, which we choose for to encode the positive class, and to be bounded below also by whatever value we choose to encode the negative class. Again, in logistic regression, we choose 0. In linear regression, we have chosen -1. So all of this generalizes also to higher dimensionalities, but higher dimensionalities are not easily visualized, which is why we will show it just here for 2 dimensions. Again, let's look at this logistic model function again. This is the model function that we have in general here. Oh, sorry. So we have y of x equals 1 divided by 1 plus e to the power of minus w transposed times x. And specifically for this example, this will look like this. We have y of x1, x2, these are the two feature values we have, the two-dimensional feature space, and this would then be computed as 1 divided by 1 plus e to the power of minus w0 plus w1 times x1 plus w2 times x2. So it's all very straightforward. It's just like we apply the linear, we use the linear regression function and input it into our logistic model function to obtain this shape in our model function, for our hyperplane that we train. And again, we choose in logistic regression 0.5 to discriminate between positive and negative examples. And as you remember, in the two-dimensional case, this yields a line which cuts through this hyperplane. And for prediction, again, we say that a given X, which represents an email, is spam or belongs to the class 1, if and only if it's a predicted value given by the sigmoid function of the weight vector multiplied with the feature vector is bigger or is equal or greater than 0.5. Otherwise, we say it belongs to the class 0. So this all corresponds basically to what we have already seen in linear regression. We can also project this again into the feature space, and what we obtain again is a line between the positive and the negative examples. And if we just look at the values computed by the linear part of the regression function that we have, if that value is below zero, we will have again the negative examples, and if that value is greater than or equal to zero, we have the positive examples. So this correspondence here is not by accident, it is by construction. And it also tells us a bit about how powerful logistic regression is compared to linear regression. It is basically equally as powerful. We can tackle the same problems with logistic regression as we can tackle with linear regression. The only difference is that we have, hopefully, and I will try to show this to you again in a minute, we have, by constructing the logistic regression model function this way, fixed some of the problems that linear regression has. All of this is again written here on the remarks slide as well. So the difference between linear regression and logistic regression is not just the model function that we chose, but also in the loss computation. Loss computation means what kind of error we choose to compute in order to update the weights in each learning step in our, for example, iterative learning algorithm, which could be the LMS algorithm, which you have already seen in the introductory slides. Let this function L here, which takes as input the model function y for a given example x and the actual class prediction by our classifier for the same example, be the pointwise loss. Pointwise because we look at only one example. So we look at only one of these pluses here, or one of the minuses. One positive or one negative example goes into this function, and therefore we compute just the loss for this particular example. You will often see in the literature that a different loss function is found. This is the global loss function, which is usually denoted by a calligraphic L. I can show you here on the mark slide, sorry, skip ahead. So by this calligraphic L. This is the global loss function, which computes or which accumulates all the losses over all x in our training examples. Just to go back quickly. So what we are now looking just at the pointwise loss for this particular example x. And for linear regression, we have two basic loss functions that we could look at. There are many more have been devised and studied, but let's look at these two ones, which we have seen before. It is basically the 0-1 loss and the squared loss. The 0-1 loss basically looks at the sign of the model function yx. Remember, now we are in linear we are looking at linear regression again, so our model function looks like this. We just have y of x equals the weight vector transposed multiplied by the feature vector, and we just look at the sign and compare this sign of the model function, whether it's positive or negative, and compare that with the sign of the classifier function for the same example, and take this as an indicator whether we have made an error, which would then be a value of 1, or whether we have made no error, which would then be a value of, no, of 0 for the 0-1 loss. Compare this, and let me quickly switch a slide. This will take a minute, just a second. This one, yes. So you should see a different slide now, I hope. It is the true misclassification rate, which you have seen in evaluating effectiveness. Can you see the slide?
Yes.
Thank you. So compare the 0-1 loss, as I defined it just now, with the true misclassification rate here. Again, in this formula, we just look at whether how many examples from the number of examples for which the predicted value by the model function equals, or in this case, not equals, the classifier function, and calculate the amount of misclassifications compared to the amount of examples we have. This is very similar to what is happening in the 0-1 loss. Let me switch back quickly. You should now see the other slide again. If not, let me know. So here again, for comparison, here we say we get a value of 0 in our loss or error function if we happened to predict the right sign of the class, or we say we get a 1 otherwise. The squared loss, you will also notice, or we will also have a deja vu with regards to what we have done before in linear regression. The squared loss L2 for a given example, given the model function and the classifier, is simply the difference between the predicted value for x and the class value, and all that value being squared. So it is basically the residual, the difference between what we predicted and what we wanted, squared. And let me show you again the resemblance to the RSS function, so that you can see that this is nothing new, but only basically the pointwise version of what we have seen before in linear regression. Here you see in the linear regression case, we have the RSS function, which simply computes exactly this difference squared. So this would correspond to our class value that we want to have, and this would correspond to our value that we have predicted given these feature weights and the feature vector x, and all of this is squared and then again summed. So the RSS function would correspond to the global loss, whereas every term inside the sum would correspond to a pointwise loss given this feature vector x1. Let's switch back. I find the right slide, sorry. Here it is. So this would then be the squared loss. And you can see the similarities there. There's no difference in terms of what we compute. We just compute these two loss functions for an individual example. We can also try to understand what these loss functions do a bit more in this illustration. So this is the illustration you know. We have the discrimination line that we have projected into the feature space. So if we go back here, you can see this projection that we did, right? But remember, we are in the linear regression case, so it would actually correspond to the line that we have on this hyperplane. There's a difference. So this is the discrimination line. We have a couple of positive and a couple of negative examples in a two-dimensional space with two features, x1 and x2. And if we now would take a cross-section through this space and look at it from the side, I will show you how this works in a minute, then we would see a situation like this here. We would look at basically a cross-section of this plane. It is the plane that we have trained, and we would see positive examples and negative examples as per their class prediction, and we would see basically the blue line here being the plane that we have fitted using these weights. And this green point here is not is basically if we look directly at this discrimination line, basically at this tipping point of the of discrimination line, if we look right into the line. So for illustration, we take the cross section like this, this gray shade here, and then we rotate this by 45 degrees to make it parallel with the abscissa of this coordinate system. And we rotate again this space by 90 degrees, basically looking into the plane. Or if we go back here, we now look alongside this blue line here. Right? So what we would see is a situation like this. And this again is the point at which our decision changes. So if we were to move along this cross section and at each point check, are we a positive example yet? Then we would see that at this point exactly, our decision would change. Now let's look at a particular example X and do exactly what I just told. We move it along this cross section and see then how these two loss functions, L01 or 01 loss and L2, the squared loss, changes. Let's look at the 01 loss first. We have a positive example, so an example for which we know it is positive. So it is definitely a plus. You can see also here the parameter that we chose. And we compute now the 01 loss for this example while we move it alongside the cross section. And for this, we obtain precisely this step curve. So as long as the positive example is still below the model value of zero, so it is still on a point on the hyperplane that we have trained that is far away from the discrimination line here. So we move the positive example along this trajectory here, along this cross section, or basically along this abscissa. We obtain a one until that point when the decision changes, and we then obtain a zero loss. So starting, if our positive example would start to be somewhere around here, or basically somewhere around here, and we would move it along, we would always be on the positive side and never obtain an error. For as long as the positive example is to the left of this, the error would be one, and our learning algorithm, if it would take this example as a learning exercise, would then have to adjust the weights and try to adjust the weights based on this error that we have computed. It serves as a penalty for the learning algorithm in order to change basically the slope of this linear model function or this hyperplane. If we now look at the same squared loss and compute basically also the squared loss while we are moving a positive example along this cross section, we obtain this function. So as long as the example is far away on the left side of the hyperplane or on the negative side of the discrimination line, we obtain a very high squared loss. And this squared loss diminishes as we move along the cross section, gets smaller, smaller, and smaller, and gets zero at that point when the positive example actually reaches a prediction value of one, which is exactly the value we want, we expected from this positive example. And the value then increases again as the predicted value goes further up on the plane, basically on the fitted plane here. Or as the distance to the discrimination line increases. And perhaps you can already see the problem that we have with using this loss function. You will, if you have not seen it, don't worry. You will see in a minute when we compare this situation to the loss functions that we use in logistic regression. Again, same situation. We look at the loss functions, the pointwise loss functions that are used to penalize wrongly classified examples in a learning algorithm, in this case for logistic regression. Here, we usually use different loss functions. So we keep the 0-1 loss for comparison. Sometimes it may also be used, but more commonly, the so-called logistic loss is used, L sigma. And this is a two-part function which computes the negative logarithm of the predicted model value of x if x happens to be a positive example, and otherwise it computes one minus the predicted model value, or the negative logarithm of one minus the predicted model value. The reason why we compute a logarithm is because by construction, the model function outputs a value between 0 and 1, and taking the logarithm of those gives us a higher error value. And since taking the logarithm of values between 0 and 1 gives us a negative value, we take the negative value of that. So let's look at the same illustration again. We have our input space in two dimensions. We have our discrimination line, which is now a plane that has been fitted using the logistic regression function here, the logistic model function. And we take a cross section again through this space. We rotate it just the same way, 45 degrees to the left, to the right, and 90 degrees into the slide, and we obtain basically this view again. Our plane, our sideways view onto the plane through the cross section is like this, and if we choose again to look on the abscissa at this plane, basically, it is not the same as the model function here, we get again a point at which our decision changes. So let us illustrate again how the loss functions look like. The 0-1 loss looks just the same as before. And we have the step function again. If we move a positive example alongside this cross section from left to right, we see that the step of the 0-1 loss changes. However, the logistic loss function looks wildly different compared to the squared loss functions that we have seen before. In the beginning, it acts very similarly to the squared loss by diminishing the computed penalty or the computed loss as long as the example gets closer to the expected value of one. Remember, we have a positive example here, and we move it alongside this cross section, and the closer we get to a predicted value of one, the smaller the logistic loss. However, if we move the example beyond WTX equals one, so if we move the example further away into the positive space here, the loss only diminishes. And this is by construction of the logistic loss function. And this is the reason why logistic regression solve this problem. It works in this regard better than the squared loss functions that we have seen here. Any example that exceeds the expected value of positive examples, one in our model function, would get a very high squared loss, because this function is symmetric around this value. And there's actually no good reason to assign such a high loss to examples which are positive or more positive than other examples. And this is basically what is being fixed here. So to finish, you will basically, or so that to make sure, Michael, did I forget anything, or would you have a different view on this that I failed to tell?
I could go into a few more details if you like, but
if you have
don't
something
think you forget
that I should have told also, then go ahead, just do it, no worries.
Okay.
Yeah, do you want to take over the slides, or?
I think that would help. I would probably jump around a bit.
I think you can just take the screen share.
It seems so. Okay. So okay, this is still a bit odd. There, that's better. So I want to go into maybe a few points and make sure that everyone understands them. So first of all, let's maybe go back to this picture just to make sure this is clear to everyone. So what happens here when we modify the weight vector, right? Because the points that we have in our data set, they are fixed in the same position in this two-dimensional feature space that we have here, and the parameters to our weight vector they determine where this decision boundary is. So we, in a two-dimensional feature space, the weight vector describes a three-dimensional plane. So we have always one additional dimension because of the output space that we also have to consider. So and the weight vector corresponds to the normal to this plane. So that means basically the decision boundary that we saw in the other picture corresponds to the intersection of the plane with the y equals zero line in this case. So that means when we change w, the orientation of this plane in the three-dimensional space changes. So might look like this with for some other value of w, and then also this intersection with the y equals zero plane changes, and that is what moves our decision boundary around. So then if we go back to this view projected into the feature space, then that leads to this line moving around and ultimately classifying points differently. So then if we get this line, we might our hypothesis might assign this point to the negative class instead, and this point as well. So, and that is what we are measuring in this picture as well. So we are here considering essentially one particular example of a weight vector that corresponds to this line, and then we are, like Martin already explained, projecting such that we are looking at the line from this direction, basically. So this is where the eye position would be in the second picture. So we are this green point here is this line now, and the gray arrow direction is the same as the gray arrow in this picture. So this distance on the x-axis here is the value of the scalar product of the weight vector and the particular point that we are looking at, and this corresponds to the distance of the point from the plane or from the line in the two-dimensional case here. So just that I think makes sense to clarify. further this 0-1 loss here. This corresponds to the true classification error. So ultimately, when we are at some point finished training our classification model, the 0-1 loss is what we are really interested in, because that tells us what our classifier gets right and what our classifier gets wrong. The problem with the 0-1 loss is that we cannot optimize it, because it is a non-continuous function. So you see this in the graph. In this picture again, we have the same x-axis as here, and here we have the 0-1 loss assignment. So let's say now when we no longer have this this line fixed, but we modify our weight vector, how we how we compute this, this is also something we can get briefly into later. Thank you for the question. So as I said, the points are all fixed, but when we modify W, this line moves around, and with it, this entire coordinate system here also moves around in this space. So from the perspective of this coordinate system, then the points move. And if we look at one individual point, and in this plot here, we say this is a positive point, and we move the weight vectors such that the point moves in this direction through this coordinate system, then at some when it's say to the left of our decision boundary here, we are classifying it wrongly. That means our 0-1 loss is 1, and as we modify our hypothesis to at some point make the point cross the decision boundary, we are then classifying it correctly here, and our 0-1 loss becomes 0. The problem with optimizing this kind of thing is that we cannot really tell by computing the gradient in which direction we have to modify our weight vector when we have a weight vector that puts a positive point here versus one that puts it here. So clearly this one is better, but we cannot say by how much it is better or in which direction we would have to modify this one to get here. That's why we use these differentiable loss functions, like we did with the square loss in the linear regression case. So what we ultimately want to do is compute the derivative with respect to the weight vector of this, and with the square loss, this is possible. I'm not going to do it in very much detail here, but just to give you an idea where to start. So that means we have to differentiate the scalar product of the weight vector with x minus, and let's just say our class is 0. So we only consider half of the cases here to make this more simple. And then clearly we can simply apply the chain rule, right? So this is something like 2 times and then the derivative of this scalar product, which is a linear function. So it's easy to derive. So we basically go through by every individual component of W and get a linear derivative. And that is, let's say if I have this here open as well, this is something we saw early on in the lecture here when we looked at the RMS algorithm. Essentially, that is what these two lines do, which is plug in the result of this derivative with respect to W of the classification error. And that is what we use to adapt our weight vector. So that I can probably also open up again. We had this in the end of the linear regression unit where we saw this picture right here. So when we look into a space of where the coordinate system is the components of our weight vector, and the the third axis here is the loss function. We called this here residual sum of squares, which is just the sum over all examples of this pointwise squared loss that we saw on the other slide. Then we get a picture like that, a surface that is convex and that has a unique minimal point for some particular combination of weight settings. And that is what we are looking to optimize. For the 0-1 loss, we would not get a nice smooth curve like this, but we will get something that is minimal at some point and then stepwise, so we can't really optimize this nicely by infinitesimally modifying the weight vector. Okay, So yeah, that's in logistic regression, the situation is the same essentially. The 0-1 loss tells us the true classification error. This is what ultimately we want to make small. But again, here we still cannot optimize this. So you might wonder why we don't use the squared loss also for logistic regression, because we could easily do that, right? We could take this this model function that we have already accomplished constraining to the range of 0-1 and then plug this into the squared point loss. So that would give us something like 1 second. So hang on, I'm going to switch to a different window for this. I can't really draw nicely on here. No, that's not right. This is better, okay. And then there we are. So, can everyone see this blank sheet of paper now?
Yes.
Okay, nice. So the squared loss for logistic regression would look something like y of x minus c of x squared, right? And when we plug in the logistic regression formula, this would be the sigmoid function applied to the scalar product of the weight vector and x minus c of x squared. And again, let's assume C is zero for simplicity's sake. The other case is roughly analogous. And so here we plug in the sigmoid function, which is 1/(1+e^Wgx). And this is zero. So this is what we want to minimize. And in order to minimize, again, we have to take the derivative with respect to W. And the derivative with respect to W of this ultimately leads us to something that is non-convex and non-linear. So I'm not going to completely finish this. You can see that this is basically, again, several steps of the chain rule. So the first step gives you two in front here, which essentially is irrelevant for the minimization. And then you still have to derive this inner term again by W. And ultimately, you won't be able to get rid of this exponential function. And that means you don't get a nice smooth surface, but something that is very, how do you call it? Something that has many local extrema. So when you try to minimize this function, you are going to have a very hard time because you always end up in these local extrema, and where you actually want to go is the global minimum. So this would be kind of the picture in the W0, W1 space that we saw previously. And it turns out that the logistic loss, where we essentially take the logarithm of this thing, has much nicer properties in that sense. So let's see if I have this here somewhere. No, not really. Okay. Let's try. This is so. Yeah, I'm going to flip back to the slide briefly so you can see it also. So in the logistic regression case, we decide to use this loss function for exactly that reason, that we have a nicer optimization problem in the end. And this is, we accomplish this by taking the logarithm of the model function in essence, because this gets rid of the exponential, and this gives us a nice linear function to optimize. So ultimately, when we use this same, which is essentially gradient descent, we can't really call it least mean squares anymore, of course, because we're not using the squared loss as the foundation. But we end up with this same term, with the same error term in the logistic regression case. The only difference is that in when we use linear regression, then y of x equals W transpose x, right? Yeah, it says so right here. And in the logistic regression case, y of x equals the sigmoid function applied to W transpose x. But using the logistic loss, we end up with the same derivative with this other y of x part in here. And that again is easy to optimize. Okay.
I think we are more or less at the end of this part. Thank you, Michael.
Right. Sure. I hope this didn't make things more confusing. I hope I answered the question how to compute W0
yes,
and W1.
Yes, I think so. Basically,
so essentially,
use the LMS algorithm.
Yeah. Start at random values and
use the LMS algorithm.
Yeah. Start at random values and improve it in small increments. That's basically
yes. There can there are other ways, and we may get into them later, but the easiest way now is to use the LMS algorithm.